Hello everyone, this is Dinah Menezes and I'm one of the expert OET tutors working for Triyada International Academy, Mangalore. Today I'm here in order to discuss in detail regarding the writing updated criteria. Many of the people have got a little bit of confusion like what this new updated writing criteria consists of. So in order to exactly give you a clear picture regarding what are these six criteria and what exactly the examiner is going to look forward in your writing, I'll be giving you a in detail picture about this. Now, we have got six different criteria for your writing. Priorly, before the updation, we only had five criteria. Now, whatever these criteria that have been included, these will revolve around three important things of the writing task. You know that the writing task will be laid at the bottom of your question paper, which is nothing but the stimulus which have been given to you in the nursing notes form. Now, reading this particular writing task is really very, very important. First, because you see, this particular writing task will guide you regarding what is required from your side. Now, when you read this particular writing task, you are supposed to see three important things. The first thing is the profession of your reader to whom you are writing the letter. Why this is very important? Because if the profession is different, the selection of your case notes or the stimulus that you will be sending is also going to be changed. For example, if you're writing for about a patient, for a dermatologist, and maybe for a neurologist, and maybe the patient is having a history of acne vulgaris, maybe diabetes, hypertension, maybe fracture undergone in like 2013, appendicectomy done in 2015. So maybe there are a few past histories of the patient, but depending upon the profession, maybe for the dermatologist, you may only send about the acne vulgaris and the diabetes, which would be a secondary condition which could aggravate the situation to the dermatologist. And maybe for the neurologist, you may require to only send regarding the visual perception defects, diabetes, as well as the hypertension, because the increase in the pressure can also lead to these kind of problems. So it's really very important for the candidate to understand which information is basically required to be sent to the reader. The second important thing from the writing task that you have to see is about the purpose. The writing task will be clearly telling you why you are writing the letter. For example, you may be writing for follow-up care, for home visits, maybe you are writing in order to provide health education, maybe you are writing for a physiotherapist because the patient is unskilled in using maybe a walking stick. Or maybe sometimes it could be something like you may be writing for a social worker to assist with the family's financial needs. So all this kind of the purpose will be given in the writing task. And this is really very, very important to understand. The third important thing from the writing task that you have to give more importance is the patient known or you are introducing the patient for the first time? Why this is very important? For example, if the patient is a known patient, then it is really very important to understand that the known social history or maybe the known past medical history wouldn't be of that utmost important for the reader of the letter because he already knows it. So there's no point in sending the information which he's already aware about regarding the patient. Now, there are three important ways of conveying that the patient is a known client. There are three things. The first thing is that the writing task would directly guide you saying that you are writing back to the particular reader. Now this clearly says that this particular person is a known client. Whereas you have got another way of conveying where you may get somebody's known patient. For example, Farrow's pharmacist, or maybe we can say John's GP, where apostrophe S comes. Now this also basically means that the patient is known to the GP or maybe known to the pharmacist. The third way of saying is that the address of the reader and the address of the patient where he is residing, both the things will be the same. For example, imagine in the writing task they have given you that you are writing to Bel Air Nursing Home regarding the patient's condition, where they have nowhere mentioned that the patient is a known client, neither they have told that the patient is going back to the center. Whereas when you are reading the patient details, in those patient details, it's been clearly given that the patient is currently residing in Bel Air Nursing Home. So you can see that both the patient's residence address as well as the reader's residence address both are same. So in this case also, it is considered to be a known client. So these are the three important things that you have to understand. Once you understand from the writing task about these three important things, now it will be easy for you to understand what these criteria talk about. Because whatever the six criteria may be talking about, this is revolving around these three components of the writing task, which is the profession of the reader, the purpose of the letter, and then you have got, is the client known or unknown client. So now let's see regarding the six criteria in detail. The first criteria of the updated writing section is the purpose. Now when I say the purpose, I already told you that this purpose will be highlighted in the writing task of yours. Now when you are reading the particular purpose and when you are selecting the case notes for this particular purpose to accomplish, you should keep in mind two important things. Because this purpose consists of two important things over here. First thing is that whatever purpose you have selected from the case notes or that you want to depict in your case notes or maybe your letter, it should be immediately apparent to the reader. What do you mean by this? Immediately apparent to the reader means you should select the main purpose of the letter. Now, whenever a case notes has been given to you, there are two kinds of purposes. The first one is called as the main purpose and the second one is called as the secondary purpose. Now, when I am talking about the main purpose, for example, the patient is having a fall. Now, he had a fall, that's his main purpose, because you see, because of this, the patient is having mobilization problem. The secondary problem maybe could be that the patient is living alone and maybe because of that you are writing for the community health nurse to come over his home and to provide the care. So you should be able to, you know, find out what is the main purpose of your writing. Now, when I say immediately apparent, imagine that you may be writing in an emergency case. Now, when you are writing in an emergency case, you have to make sure that you write the current condition of the patient first and then what happened 2 or 3 days next. It's really very important to write like this because if you are delaying in providing the data for the reader, then there might be a chance that the situation may be fatal for the person. So that is why writing what is now, like what is the current status, what are the current vitals, what is the current skin status of the patient and everything would be much apparent to the reader rather than the next, which is the secondary data. Maybe the other example I can give is like you are writing for a social worker. So maybe in that case, you know, writing the social problem of the patient as the main highlight would be of much more importance because a social worker would like, he may require or may focus mainly on the social aspect of the person rather than the clinical aspect of the person. So that is why they say that it should be immediately apparent to the reader. The second thing is it should be sufficiently expanded. Now whatever stimulus has been given to you, you are supposed to write at least 180 to 200 words. But now there is no restriction. You can still write around more than like 230 or you know you can go beyond that. Because mainly the reader is going to see the next two criteria and decide whether you have sufficiently expanded. So let's see the second one. Now this is the content. Now what do you mean by the content? The content is nothing but that particular selected information from the case notes that you will be forwarding to the reader of your letter so that it will help him to help your patient depending upon what information you have sent to him. So here the content, necessary information is included. This is what the examiner is going to look for. He will be seeing, have you included all the relevant information what the person requires or what the reader requires in that particular situation. The next thing is, once again, it should be accurate to the reader. Now, when I say it should be accurate to the reader, you are not supposed to select any unnecessary information that the reader doesn't require in order to help the patient. So whatever information you are selecting, it should be exactly accurate to the reader as per the reader's profession, the purpose, and the client's known or unknown situation. The next criteria is conciseness and clarity. Now, when I say conciseness, as I said, you are not required to exactly write 182, 200 words. You don't require to sit and count every word. The main thing is, I told you one thing, is selecting relevant data. So the next important thing is omitting unnecessary or irrelevant data. You should be very particular in omitting those information which is basically not required for the reader. As I gave you an example in the initial stage, like the dermatologist and the neurologist, you cannot send everything what has been given in the case notes. Now, whatever you are sending, it will be totally dependent on those three important things from the writing task. Everything is oriented to these three important things. Now, and another thing says that the clarity, which means effective summary for the reader. Now, as you know, the stimulus that will be given to you, it's not in an orderly way. Is it the same way that you are writing the letter? No, because you are supposed to organize your case notes. Some important, maybe the current information is given in the top, some current information will be distributed into the discharge plan, and some current information may be found in the nursing management. So you, when you are organizing your letter, you have to bring together all this current information, make it like a story or a summary to the reader in order to understand in a better way. Now, when you're doing this, please make sure that you include the past information following to the present information in a normal case notes. Whereas I said you, in the emergency situation, the present should be of the most important thing followed by the past information. Now, the next thing is genre and style. Now, when we talk about genre and style, three important things the examiners are going to look into. The first thing is called as the register and the tone. Let's take these two together, because these basically point out for using formal language in your writing. For example, thanks a lot, thank you. Which do you think is more formal? Thank you, isn't it? So, using formal language, because you being a profession, you being a nursing professional, you are writing the case notes to another profession. And because of this, the professional way of language or communication is really very important, where you use the formal tone rather than the informal tone. And we know that we have got two voices in English. One is the active voice, another one is the passive voice. Usage of the passive voice is considered to be more formal in nature rather than using the active voice. Now, regarding active and passive voice, we will be explaining in a separate upcoming class. Now, here, use of abbreviations. Now, when we see about using of abbreviations, it's really very important to understand that you can use abbreviations. There are no restrictions for using abbreviations when you're writing a letter. But make sure you use only standardized abbreviations which are universally accepted. You cannot use your local abbreviations. We have a list of abbreviations, and only those abbreviations requires to be written. Now, another important thing while using the abbreviations you have to understand is that you cannot write abbreviations for every professional that you will be sending. Just imagine that you are writing for a veteran or maybe you're writing for a social worker, maybe a lay person, you know, they will not be able to understand all the abbreviations or all the medical standardized abbreviations. You know, it would be difficult for a lay person to understand those. The social worker would be able to understand a few, but the veterinarians and the lay person wouldn't be able to understand these abbreviations. So that is why what you have to do is, you have to decide whether in this particular case you require to send the abbreviations or no. My suggestion is that if you have any doubts, write the full form. That would be the best one, rather than, you know, taking a risk, always try to be on the safer side. Now, the fifth criteria that we have is organization and layout. Organization and layout, when we say, your letter should be in an organized manner. When you organize things and plan things accordingly, it would really help the reader as well as you to accomplish the task and communicate to each other effectively. See, planning is really very, very important. Just, you know, if you're not planned enough, you start writing a letter, you will write, rub it off, once again write and rub it off. This is going to take a lot of time. Rather, plan everything in advance. When you are well planned, I'm very sure that you can finish the letter within 30 to 35 minutes. Now, regarding organization, we have got a separate in detail class, so we will be taking the organization that time. Now, the layout. When I say about the layout, whatever you have written or laid, it should be well understanding for the reader. Now, this particular layout that you are creating, it is called as a structure. Now, in OET, you do not have a specific structure that you have to write like this only. There is nothing like that. But whatever you are writing, it should be easily understandable to the reader. That is what the reader is going to see. The moment you make the reader to read what you have written twice because he has not understood, obviously you are not going to get the desired score of B. Now, we have got the last criteria, which is a little bit tricky and majority of them have a doubt with, is the language. In language, they consider four important things. The first thing is accuracy of the grammar. This particular grammar consists of the articles, parallel sentences, difficult words, and you know, the what we say about the cohesives, about the punctuations and everything. Now, we have got separate classes for all these things which are related to the grammar. Now, then we have got the vocabulary. The words that you use, for example, depending upon the particular profession, are you sending the appropriate vocabulary? Will that particular vocabulary be easily understandable to the reader? That would be also considered. Then we have got spelling. Spelling mistakes are considered to be negative. You are not supposed to do any spelling mistakes because even one small spelling mistake can be considered as a big problem. Especially imagine that your patient's name is Mr. Alexander Jones, J-O-N-E-S, and somewhere in the letter when you have written, if you write Mr. Jones, J-O-N-E, I'm very sure you will be losing because you see you have changed the identity of the patient. So that is why it's really very, very important to avoid doing any spelling errors, especially with the patient's name. And the last one is about the punctuations. Which is nurse's favorite punctuation? Isn't it the comma? So, you should be very careful about the usage of the comma. Comma, for example, when we are working in the bedside, we use commas like literally. We don't have rules and regulations. Every other, you know, word we'll be using commas. But there are certain rules and regulations for commas which we'll be talking in detail in the upcoming classes. Now, so these are the sixth important criteria that have been evolved after the updated criteria for writing came into existence. So I hope there was a lot of requests from the students regarding one class regarding the updated criteria in detail. So I hope I have cleared all your doubts. For further information, please do visit